start a new Rust project and add boson, raw window handle, and winit as dependencies. Now import the boson prelude. First, you'll want to initialize winit like any other application. Next, you'll want to create the context. The context is your gateway to boson. It starts at the Vulkan backend and roughly translates to the Vulkan instance. You'll want to set enable validation to false, as we don't want to tell the backend that we'd like to print debug information. We also want to set our application name, and we can set the rest of the parameters to default, as almost everything in this library has a default. Next, you'll want to create the device. The device is your handle to the system GPU. It automatically selects the most capable GPU on your system. Then you'll want to get the raw display handle and raw window handle from Winit. Next, define a function for resizing the application. The swap chain manages the images which are sent to the monitor to be displayed. You must use the device to acquire images from the swap chain in your render graph. We put this inside a function because we want to change it when it's resized. Then inside of this function, we also want to call the record function, which we'll get to later. Then we define the swap chain render graph variable, and we do the initial resize. Then we create a pipeline compiler. A pipeline compiler allows us to load and hot reload pipelines. By default, it chooses no underlying compiler. You'd probably want this if you're shipping Spurvy in a binary to someone without the Vulkan SDK. The source and asset directory defaults to the current working directory. Then you'll want to create your render pipeline. By default, Boson will inject the hashtag define and the shader type in lowercase. For example, the first shader will have hashtag define vertex, and the second shader will have hashtag define fragment. Then you'll want to specify the color attachment that you will be using in this pipeline. The only thing that is required is to specify the format, otherwise the format will be unknown. Semaphore facilitates synchronization between different parts of the GPU pipeline. In this example, we signal the acquire semaphore when we get an image from the swap chain. Then we wait for the signal to be processed by the GPU before we signal the present semaphore. This allows the GPU to process multiple frames at a time without tripping on itself. These are not necessary if you're making a render graph that is only executed once. The data as you're seeing it here lives on the CPU. To move data from the CPU to the GPU, we need a buffer that lives on the CPU and can move data to the GPU. This is called a staging buffer usually, and it is a buffer with host access. Of course, we want to tell Boson that we'd like to be able to read and write to and from this buffer from the CPU. In addition, to demonstrate the usage of resources, we will create a buffer that holds one value, the amount of time that has passed since the start of execution, such that we can move the triangle based on time. We don't need any special parameters here. You must pass in a struct that contains all the information you would like to use in the render graph. In Levy, for example, I use the entity component system world type. However, you can use any struct that you define. The struct will need a clone of the device handle to acquire the next swap chain image, as well as the swap chain handle. We'll also need access to the semaphores for proper synchronization. We need the buffers that we previously defined, as well as the render pipeline. We'll also need to send to the shader, either through a buffer or a push constant, the value of the buffer address so that the shader knows where in memory your buffer is. We'll also want to send the time information in the render info. Now for the record function. Here comes the fun part. We use the device to start building a render graph. A render graph is just what it sounds like. Graph. The nodes of this graph are the work that you do, and the edges are determined based upon how you use the resources in your application. You need to access the swap chain regardless of whether you use this render graph or presentation to the screen. The task is a unit of work for the GPU. Synchronization happens between tasks. Things inside a task may be reordered unless explicitly specified not to through the use of command pipeline barrier. Underneath the hood, the render graph tracks resource usage and calls command pipeline barrier for you. Then we'll need to specify our resources. This closure tells the render graph what resource you're using. It is pulled every frame. And this tells the render graph how you would like to use the resource. It is very important this is accurate to your use case, or you may get a crash or undefined behavior. Now for the task. We'll want to write to the staging buffer. You'll want to specify the buffer index in the resource vector. You'll also want to specify the offset of where you'll be writing into the buffer. And then you'll want to specify the source slice, which is copied bit for bit into the buffer. Now we'll want to copy from the staging buffer to the time buffer. Here comes the super fun part, drawing to the screen. This resource acquires the next image from the swap chain. Essentially, the image we can draw to, and it's also the image which is drawn to the screen. We'll want to specify this as a color attachment in our image access. And then we'll specify the default image aspect. It, of course, defaults to color images. If you're using a depth image, you'll want image aspect depth. And if you're using a stencil buffer, you'll want image aspect stencil. We'll also want access to the time buffer in our vertex shader. We then specify the closure as move so that it can take the values of width and height. No need for render passes here, just start rendering. Of course, we'll need to specify the attachment that was also specified in the pipeline, and we'll want to specify the index into the resource vector. We'll want to say this is going to be a clear operation, and then we'll want to clear the image to blank. We're not going to use the depth buffer, and we're not going to use the stencil buffer. And then we'll want to specify the render area from 0 to 0 to width and height. There's supposed to be proper error handling, so make sure you add this question mark to return errors only. Then we'll want to specify the resolution, and we'll also want to flip everything on the y-axis such that everything is upside down. Now note, everything in Vulkan is upside down by default compared to OpenGL. That's why we want to set this to true. Now a push constant is like data that hitches ride with the command to the GPU. Make sure the representation of this type is repRC. We also need to know the pipeline to set the push constant for. Finally, before rendering, we specify the pipeline you will use. Then we draw three vertices and we end the rendering. Now we will want to create another task which also uses the swap chain image. This will return the same image within the same frame. When you go to the next frame, it will send the next image and so on and so forth. Then we will want to tell the render graph to send the tasks to the GPU. And we'll also want to tell the render graph to tell the GPU to draw what we drew to the screen. Finally, to finish off the record function, we'll want to call complete on our render graph builder. Then we'll specify our render info using all of the data that we have previously defined. Then we'll get the start time, and then we'll start the winit event loop. We'll want to set this as pulse so that it runs every frame. And then we'll also want to update the time in the render info. Finally, you can call the render method on the render graph in order to start rendering. Last but not least, we'll have to write the shader. First, we set the version to 450. Then we want to include boson.glsl. Then we define our time buffer. We also define our push constants. Then we say if vertex is defined, we use this function. Otherwise, if fragment is defined, we use this function. Now for the vertex shader, we'll want to send a color information to the fragment shader. We'll also want to get the time from the time buffer. And then we'll want to get the position of our triangle vertices and also the color of our triangle vertices. And then we'll want to make the triangle oscillate back and forth. Finally, we specify the position of the vertices that we have previously defined. Then in the fragment shader, we just take the color from the vertex shader and we output that for each fragment. That's it. You've successfully used Boson to draw a triangle to the screen.